Pues sí, animada.
Nuestra, antes de que presente nuestra próxima presentante, our last presenter, Leonel López, he wanted to probably say this and forgot. His presentation was dedicated to his father, who was a member of Trio in Mexico City, and for obvious reasons, distance perhaps, was not able to be here, and he saw the humanity and got emotional. It's very difficult for our students at times to have their parents here, because there is that distance. And with us today, we do have parents who came all the way from Mexico City and from Michoacán. Ella Marisa Garcia's parents came from Jalisco, and Ms. Ramos came from Michoacán. So we welcome our parents who come from all distances. We also have parents who come from more locally, I think from Marin County, is that?
Sonoma County.
Sonoma County, yeah. And this morning we had other parents. So we welcome our parents in to this activity, of course, and it's good that you can accompany your children. They're no longer children, but they are children. your sons and daughters in their capsule activities. Our next presenter takes us on another journey. Jessica Holt, when she first talked to me about doing the presentation, she really wanted to do something relative to literature, and she wanted to do something that she felt very passionate about. So she chose a topic that is very gender related. And you know, I mentioned earlier this morning that our students, in following our core values as a university, the idea sometimes of racial issues, gender issues, social issues are at the core of what we want our students to really take from the university. And of course, Jessica's presentation is going to demonstrate that, so she'll tell you what it's all about.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Jessica Holt. And before I start the presentation, I just wanted to make it clear that there is some words in this presentation which are for a mature audience only. I am presenting today the topic of female sexuality as presented in four novels. The first novel is Eva Luna by Isabel Allende, The Miskiwala Letters by Ana Castillo, El Pájaro, Pincel y Tinta China by Ana Lucía Portela, and Oficio de Tinieblas by Rosario Castellanos. The first author we have is Ana Lucía Portela. She's a Cuban writer. She's written various novels, and she won a UNEAC award in 1997 and the Juan Rufo Award in the year 2000. The next author I have is Rosario Castellanos. She was a professor and a writer. She grew up in the Chiapas region of Mexico, and she writes a lot about politics in Mexico, as well as the consciousness of the mestizo, as well as women's issues. Next author is Isabel Allende. She's a writer. She was born in Peru, raised in Chile, and lived in Venezuela for many years. So she has influences from all different parts of Latin America. She's also written another novel that she's very famous for called House of the Spirits. Our next author is Ana Castillo. She was born in Chicago, and she started her career in 1975. She's well known for many novels, and one of her most well-known novels is So Far From God. Why did I choose these authors? They're all feminists. They're from different parts of Latin America and the US, and they all develop female characters. The books I chose. The first book I chose was El Pájaro, Pincel y Tinta China. This is a book about the journey of Camila, a young woman growing up in La Habana, Cuba, and she has an abusive relationship with a man named Fabian. I examine different elements of her sexuality from her young adulthood into womanhood, including the idea that because of her sexuality, she's crazy. She's considered crazy. Next book is Eva Luna, and this is the book about the woman Eva Luna. We examine her life from birth into womanhood, examining different elements of her sexuality as she grows and learns about herself. Next book is Oficio de Tinieblas. There are two main female characters in this book. We have Catalina and Julia. Both are in different class levels, And both women struggle against Mexican society to become independent women. Neither woman, interestingly enough, has children. Catalina because of sterility, and Julia because she chooses not to. The next book we have is The Misquiwala Letters by Ana Castillo. This is the adventures of two women, Teresa and Alicia, who communicate through letters from young adulthood through middle age. Although we only see Teresa's letters, they both explore their sexuality through various relationships and adventures as they grow. Why did I choose these books? The characters develop their sexuality outside of societal norms. Another reason is they break limitations that were put on women by society. There are a variety of stories and different ways of presenting sexual freedom in these stories. What is female sexuality? As defined in the American Heritage Dictionary, sexuality is the condition of being characterized and distinguished by sex. Feminine is of or relation to woman. I did my own personal definition because I don't feel that this definition is exactly what it means. So I defined it as an intimate part in the mind of a woman, that which cannot be separated from self-esteem, pride, or power. The next topic that I wish to address within these novels is virginity. The image of the Virgin Mary, who conceived a child without sin, is an important role model set for women. Virginity is considered a woman's honor and something she must maintain until virginity, as well as the honor of her family. Guilt is used at all times because women are usually made to feel guilty to maintain their virginity. An example of this is Teresa in the Misquiwala Letters. In a confession to a priest, she tells him that she's still a virgin. In his response, he accused outright, "Are you going to tell me that you haven't wanted to be with a man? You must have let one do more than what?" This is an example of, even though she's a virgin, she's still accused of having sexual desires. Virginity is seen as a sign of pureness, and losing one's virginity is cause to make her not pure as a woman. Macho-ness is a part of society which influences and dictates to women that they must remain virgin to hold on to their honor or pureness. An example of this is in the novel Eva Luna. Es tu único tesoro. Mientras tengas pureza, vales algo. Cuando la pierdes, ya no eres nadie, decía. Y yo no comprendía por qué justamente aquella parte de mi cuerpo, pecaminosa y prohibida, resultaba al mismo tiempo de tanto valor. I translated this quote into English as well. It's your only treasure. While you have pureness, you are worth something. When you lose it, you aren't anybody anymore, she would say. And I didn't understand why exactly that part of my body, sinful and off limits, came to be at the same time so valuable. Here we see how the author presents the macho point of view, yet breaks it down with the confusion of the little girl who doesn't understand why this would be. To women, two classical roles have been assigned that may be traced to the roots of all myths throughout history, that of virgin, mother, nature, on one hand, whore, witch, mystic, on the other. First, I'd like to explain for a second why I chose to use this language, because it was a topic of some debate. I chose to use the word whore because the way women are judged and confined to that role within literature, and that's why I choose to use that specific word. Quiero explicar también por qué escogí usar la palabra puta, por la forma en que las mujeres son juzgadas y condenadas a ese papel dentro de la literatura. All right, the role, there's two different roles as stereotypes of roles as judged in literature. Usually there's the role of the good girl, who's presented as that of virgin, everybody loves her, men fall in love with her, she succeeds, self-sacrificing, she always controls physical desire, and she's usually religious. Then we have the role of the whore, who's bad, a seductress. Men don't love her, yet she's always desired by them. She lets go with her physical desires, and she dresses very provocatively, doesn't follow common beliefs of what society expects of her. So here we have the good girl versus the whore. The roles of the good girl versus the whore are predominant in literature. Female characters are usually placed within these stereotypes that I mentioned above, and it is often difficult for authors to break free of these stereotypes when developing a woman character. Characters are often judged within the context of these four novels, as in the case of Rosario Castellanos. who uses judgment to show the reader the unjustness of placing women within these roles, unveiling stereotypes and bringing them out in the open. After taking a young girl to her boss to be raped, a character Mercedes gets mad at her for throwing something.
India desgraciada, no te vaya yo a agarrar que no salís viva de mis manos. Mira que venir a hacerme perjuicios, puta malnacida.
I translated this quote to, disgraceful Indian, don't let me catch you or you won't get away from me alive. Look at that coming to do me wrong, bad-blooded whore. So we see here the unjustness of putting the young girl in this role, and it makes you realize why are we putting women in this role in the first place. Another example of how Portela in Pájaro Pincel y Tinta China broke down a stereotype of the good girl in the macho society is with her character Camila.
Tú no te acuestas con Cecil, es lo mismo, yo sé que tú eres tú y yo soy yo, no estoy esquizofrénica, no, ni tengo problemas de identidad. Para serte franco, no me queda muy clara la diferencia, porque yo no puedo hacer lo que tú haces.
And then that translation is, don't you sleep with Cecil? It's the same thing. I know that you're you and I'm me. I'm no schizophrenic, nor do I have identity problems. To be frank with you, it's not very clear to me the difference. Why can't I do with what you do? So here she's trying to develop a character that doesn't want to be put in that role just because she does what a man does. Then we come to the neutral female image. It's that when the myths and stereotypes about women are broken down, making the woman more of a realistic person. She is imperfect, but she recognizes her own sexuality and makes reasonable decisions. A critic, Alcaron, talks about Teresa in the Miskiwala letters. Which one of the various selves that she explores is she? Is she the vampish one, the fearful one, the liberated one, or the oppressed one? Insofar as each is connected with her sexuality, she is all of them and more. And this demonstrates how Castillo broke down the stereotypes, making a neutral feminine image. Another important part of female sexuality is maternity, because it is a result of sexuality. Pregnancy can be seen in many ways in literature. It can condemn or save a woman, depending on her status. If she's an unmarried woman, it can condemn her. But if she's married and her husband wants a child, it can save her, face in front of everybody. Sterility is an important aspect because many women are blamed and even abandoned for being sterile. I have an example from Oficio de Tinieblas, Catalina la Estéril. Pero qué sabía de la maternidad más que tantas madres. Había dado de sí, como en el parto, a cada acto de adoración, de admonición, de consejo. Catalina the Sterile. But who knew better than so many mothers about maternity? She had given from herself, like in birth, in every act of adoration, admonishment, and advice given. The author is trying to show here how even though she's a mother raising the child, she's still condemned for being sterile and not being able to give birth. There are two aspects in el aborto. When I translate that into English, I translate it into abortion and miscarriage. Both can affect women negatively. Guilt is usually placed on them for both in different ways. I have an example from the Miskiwala letters where a woman gets an abortion. You never think of anyone but yourself. And she responds, do you think that while I lay on that table, having life sucked out from between my legs, I thought of myself? You come here drunk as if this is your home, expecting me to cook, make love, when the only thing I want to do is vomit with disgust. I think the quote speaks for itself in showing that she didn't do it for herself, but because of the fact that she knew that she couldn't go on with her life having that child. Birth is seen as a sacrifice of woman, the pain that she goes through giving life to her child. In the fact of being a mother, there are many stereotypes. There's the stereotype that they're no longer sexual, that there's either the good mother who's all self-sacrificing, or the mother that abandons, the bad mother. These stereotypes are usually dismantled within this novel. Having a mother who's still a woman, who's still a person in the neutral image that I presented earlier. In conclusion, these four authors have exposed traditional myths and stereotypes about women, and they have broken them down. They have allowed women of the 20th century to develop female characters and their sexuality that are not tied to traditional expectations of society.
Hacía falta justicia en la mujer.
Ay, gracias.
Ay, quiere Abraham.
Oh, Abraham quiere.
Abraham quiere.
¿Quieres un besito?
We are right on schedule. We have again a few minutes for snacks. We'll have our next presenter get herself ready. So please enjoy what we have. We have coffee or something.
Yo voy a traer una mujer playera, que su nombre sea Martín, que su nombre sea Martín. Loco por ti, de amor, tenga como colores la espuma blanca de Latinoamérica. Este país sem nome, este tango, este rancho, dizer-lhe, arde o fogo de conhecê-la, o fogo de conhecê-la.
Good, thanks.
Hicieron un...
Para ver.